أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بفضل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي علا في توحده ودنا في تفرده وجل في سلطانه وعظم في أركانه فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين مولانا ومولى الموحدين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الغر الميامين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد Once again, we thank Almighty Allah سبحانه وتعالى for gracing us with this wonderful opportunity in this beautiful and holy month of Ramadan. Month of self-building, month of seeking nearness to Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, month of taking our spirituality to the next level, month of taking our social status to the next level, in the lens of glorious Quran or in the lens of our beloved, merciful creator. We ask Almighty Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, to make us worthy of being his true slaves and servants, and make us among the most successful ones during the fast of the holy month of Ramadan. Ilahi Amin. The verse I've just quoted, Mu'mineen and Mu'minat, is a known verse, I'm sure, to all of us. Because we often this verse, or we often hear this verse be recited, especially when our loved ones depart from this world. That is the first verse of Surah Al-Qadr. Inna anzalnahu fi laylat al-qadr. Now, my topic of discussion is to unlock the secrets of the night of Qadr in the lens of this beautiful ayah. This topic will be of two episodes. Tonight is the first episode, and inshallah, tomorrow will be the last and final episode on unlocking the secrets of the night of Qadr. Last night, we spoke about the secret of dua. And these two are connected, interlinked. Because the night of Qadr is about dua. It's about swimming in that spiritual ocean of the presence of Almighty Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a night to be yourself, not to pretend. And so therefore, it's important we prepare ourselves in advance before the main night of the holy month of Ramadan arrive. No doubt, all the days and nights of the holy month of Ramadan are leading to the night of Qadr. Nights of Qadr are the summary of the holy month of Ramadan. We ask Allah not to deprive us of the real tastes of the night of Qadr. My examination of tonight will be of the following stages. First stage is to remind ourselves of the general overview of Surah Al-Qadr. Second stage of my examination is to look at the three stages of the existence of glorious Quran, the month of Quran also. And the third stage of my examination is to look at the divisions of the verses of glorious Quran into clear and ambiguous verses. And the last stage of my examination is in a form of rhetorical question. Why did Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala send Jibra'il to beloved Prophet alayhi ala fa tahiyyatu wa salam? First stage of the examination is overview of Surah Al-Qadr, which we know, but just to serve as a reminder, this chapter, without a shadow of doubt, as it has been discussed in the books of Tafsir, is Makki chapter, meaning revealed in the holy city of Makkah. And you know very well the features of the verses revealed in the holy city of Makkah. Mostly those verses discuss the concept of monotheism and believing Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, calling human beings. Some are of the view that this chapter was revealed in Medina. And the reason is that they said one day the holy prophet of Islam had a dream that Banu Umayyah were climbing his member. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, after the dream, revealed this chapter to console our beloved prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So Allah mentioned Alf Shahar. And scholars said this Alf Shahar is the period of time that Banu Umayyah led and they were in authority. And of course, the member of the prophet is in Medina. So they said the chapter was revealed in Medina. But the most celebrated opinion is that opinion that the chapter was revealed in the holy city of Makkah. And of course, this chapter discusses Qadr and the importance of Qadr and the barakah of Laylatul Qadr, as you know. Suffice to say, we have beautiful narration from the Holy Prophet of Islam that whoever recites Surah Al-Qadr once sincerely for the sake of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, of course, while understanding the meaning of Surah Al-Qadr, you will be given the reward of fasting the whole month of Ramadan and keeping awake during the night of Qadr. And you know, of course, we have a riwayah also that says that whoever recites Surah Al-Qadr 7 times for his marhumin, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will ease the situation of the marhumin in their lives of barzakh. And there are other merits of Surah Al-Qadr or fada'il. Now, the second stage of my examination is very important stage. But the Holy Quran has 3 stages of its existence or to its existence. The first stage is the stage of the general existence of glorious Quran. I will explain later. Second stage of the existence of glorious Quran is the revelation of glorious Quran to the heart of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. This is what scholars call once off revelation. And the third stage of the existence of glorious Quran is the revelation of the verses of glorious Quran one after the other in both Mecca and Medina through reasons for revelation within a period of 23 years. These are the 3 stages of the existence of glorious Quran. Let's take them one after the other. We are believers, we are Muslims. Quran is our guide. And so it's so important we understand this book and affiliate ourselves with this book, especially beginning in this holy month of Ramadan. You know, we have beautiful tradition in Bihar al-Anwar that inna Ramadana awwalu sana. But indeed, the holy month of Ramadan marks the beginning of the year. Beginning of the year of what? The year of self-purification or self-building. That's what the holy month of Ramadan is all about. And so our beloved prophet mentioned, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ الْعَبْدُ مَا فِي رَمَضَانِ لَوَدَّ أَنْ يَكُونَ السَّنَةَ رَمَضَانِ or لَوَدَّ أَنْ يَكُونَ رَمَضَانُ السَّنَةَ. Indeed, if the servant of Allah will recognize what is Ramadan, he will wish the entire year to be Ramadan. Now let's look at the first stage of the existence of glorious Quran. That is the general existence of Quran. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, this glorious and holy book that we have, which is the miracle of our beloved prophet, had existence in another realm before its existence in this world, before it was revealed in this world. And this is not only peculiar to our glorious Quran. The same thing applies to all the heavenly revealed books. Torah, Injil, Zabur, Sufi Ibrahim, they had existence in another realm before their existence in this world of matter or in this materialistic world. You know, if you go to Surah Al-Rahman, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said, الرحمن علم القرآن. Then he said what? خلق الإنسان. He said الرحمن. Then he said علم القرآن. First he taught Quran. After teaching Quran, خلق الإنسان. Then he created human beings. What does it mean? Meaning what? The existence of Quran preceded the existence of insan, or preceded the existence of the world of matter. Now, let me explain it further. You know, when a person wants to establish a business, to start a business, he has to go through certain steps before getting into operations. The first thing is feasibility studies. Then after that, he put up a system, he set up a system. And through this system, the company or the organization will function. Cash flow, whatever. So first, the system must be in place before the organization starts operating. Likewise, when it comes to Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, the first thing Allah did was to set up and establish the system. What is the system? Allama al-Quran. He taught Quran. Meaning what? Quran had existence. Why? Because Quran is the system of Allah to manage the world of materialism. So therefore, Allah first set up the system. Then after the system, what happened? Allah then created. And so therefore, this system, its realm is the first stage of the existence of glorious Quran, which scholars in the field of the science of Quran refers to it as the general existence of glorious Quran. What is general existence of the glorious Quran? It is a stage or a zone where it was only realities or the general principles of Quran, meaning like the skeleton of Quran, like the general design of glorious Quran. Of course, when Quran moved from that realm, then it came to a different realm where we have the surah, where we have the verses, where you have the words, the length, the breadth of Quran, and so forth and so forth. So therefore, the first stage of the existence of Quran is the general existence of Quran. What is general existence to do it more further, to make it more clearer, my dear brothers and sisters? It's, you know, each and everything that Allah created is made up of two existences. It has general existence and then detailed or specific existence. Let's take fruits or fruit tree. This fruit tree, at one stage, it was a seed. Then later on, this seed turned into a tree with fruit, with leaves, and so forth and so forth. Now, the general existence of this fruit tree is that seed. And then the detailed existence is what? Is the fruit you see, is the tree you see. Likewise, when you come to insan, insan has general existence and detailed or specific existence. The general existence of insan is what? Is that semen that we are born out of. That semen, insan was inside. That's the summary of insan. That's the general existence of insan. And then now, you sitting next to me, or I'm sitting next to you with two eyes, with two ears, with nose, with mouth, with hand. This is detailed and specific existence of insan. Now, Quran is the same. Quran, when it was its general existence, it was the general principles of Quran. Scholars said, Mabadi'ul Amma, general understanding of Quran. And then, of course, when it moved from there, then it became specific and detailed, as we'll be discussing, inshallah. And if you go back to Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala explains and highlights on the general existence of Quran, which is regarded as the first stage of its existence. You got Quran 56, verse 77 to 78. What does Allah say? Said, Innahu la Quranun Kareem. Indeed, it is a generous book. Generous book in what sense? Meaning whoever hold unto this book sincerely, he will find the book beneficial. But the second ayah, which is very important, 78, highlight on the general existence of Quran. He said what? Fi kitabim matlun. Quran is in kitabim matlun, in a protected place. This kitabim matlun, another ayah referred to it as what? Lawhin mahfuz, in a protected slate. That is the general existence of Quran. And it existed before each and everything was created by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Now, the second stage of the existence of Quran is the heart of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. That after the general existence, the first place that the Quran stops is the heart of prophets. When did that happen? On the night of Qadr. And that is why Quran says, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. We revealed it on the night of Qadr. What type of revelation? Once off revelation. The entirety of Quran was revealed into the heart of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Some call it inspirational revelation. Meaning what? On the night of Qadr, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala inspired our beloved Prophet with the entirety of glorious Quran. Another ayah, chapter Dukhan, verse 3. What does Allah say? He said, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakah. We indeed revealed it on a blessed night. Meaning what? The night of Qadr. So when we talk of the revelation of Quran on the night of Qadr, we are referring to the once of revelation of Quran into the heart of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. How did that happen? How did it happen that it ended up being in the heart of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam? It was through Jibreel alayhi salam. And Quran 26 verse 193 makes it very clear. He said, Nazala bihi ruhul amin ala qalbika litakuna min al mundirin bilisani arabiyin mubin. He said, the ruhul amin revealed it in your heart so that you become a warner to people. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala sent Jibreel with the entirety of Quran to put it in the heart of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam on the night of Qadr. That's the second stage of the existence of Quran. The month of Quran, we need to know about Quran. The third stage of the existence of glorious Quran is what scholars refer to as what? Wujudun tafsili. It is the detailed existence of glorious Quran. When did that happen? Within a period of 23 years, meaning Makkah 10, Medina 13. Hence, we have a Makki and Madani surahs. Something would happen and Allah would reveal the verse. Thus, we have reasons for the revelations of the verses of glorious Quran to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Where do we get that from? There are verses of Quran highlighted on the detailed existence of glorious Quran. You go to Quran 17, verse 106. Allah says, وَقُرْآنًا فَرَقْنَاهُ لِتَكْرَأَهُ عَلَى مُكْسٍ عَلَى النَّاسِ عَلَى مُكْسٍ. Allah says, وَنَزَّلْنَاهُ تَنْزِيلًا. Quran 17, 106. He said, this is the Quran, فَرَقْنَاهُ. We made it in portions so that you read to people. And we revealed it into pieces. This is what we call gradual revelation. So the third stage of the existence of glorious Quran is referring to the gradual revelation of the verses of glorious Quran in both Mecca and Medina. And another ayah beautifully also highlights on this gradual revelation of glorious Quran. Chapter Fussilat, verse 1 of Quran 11. It said, Kitabun uhkimat ayatu. In fact, this ayah highlights on the two stages of the existence of Quran. The general existence and the detailed existence. The first one says, Kitabun uhkimat ayatu. He said, it's a book whose verses was condensed general existence. And then he said, "Thumma fussilat." Then it was splitted into details. It was made details. Meaning what? The detailed existence of the glorious Quran, which is the third stage of this great book. This is the first stage of my examination. Second stage of my examination, you know, is the division of the verse of glorious Quran into clear and ambiguous verses. And then after that, we'll ask a question. What's the connection of ambiguous verses with the revelation of glorious Quran? You see, know that when you go to Surah Al Imran, verse 7, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala highlights on the types of the verses of glorious Quran. The first type he said muhkamat, and the other type Quran refers to as mutashabihat. Muhkamat means what? Clear verses. Mutashabihat means what? Ambiguous verses or unclear verses of glorious Quran. Now, what's the difference between the two before we go into details? The clear verses are verses that are clear in their meanings. If you have a background of Quran, you've studied Quran, you've understood the basis of the verse of glorious Quran, when you go to the clear verses, you find it easy and you find it understanding. But we've got what is called ambiguous verses. They are not easily understood. It is not anybody's baby. One needs to do a lot of work, extra work, to be able to extract the meanings of the ambiguous verses of glorious Quran. And there are two types of ambiguous verses. We have ambiguity in meaning, and we have ambiguity in application. What is ambiguity in meaning? You find some terms in Quran, their meanings are very ambiguous. It's difficult to extract the meaning by just looking at those terms or those verses. Typical example, Quran 5, verse 38, where Allah says, "Wasariku." He said, a male thief and a female thief should cut their hands. Now, what is the meaning of a hand here? Is it cutting the finger or cutting from the wrist or from the arm or cutting from the elbow? So scholars said, this term hand is ambiguous in meaning. That's an example. And then we've got ambiguity in application. You go to Quran 20, verse 5. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, "Ala al-arsh istawa," that Allah settled on the throne or on arsh. Here, the meaning of arsh is clear. Arsh is a zone of authority. It's a sign of having an authority. But then the application is ambiguous. Because we know arsh is a matter that has weight and occupies space. Whereas Allah is not a matter, so he does not occupy his space. Allah is not limited by time, and it's not limited by space. So how do we apply this arsh on Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala? This is what they call ambiguity in application. Now, what's the connection between ambiguous verses and the revelation of Quran? Because we are discussing the revelation of glorious Quran on the night of Qabr. Scholars said when Quran was in its general existence, and when Quran was in the heart of the Holy Prophet, there was no any ambiguity. The ambiguity came as a result of this world of matter, when Quran was revealed within a period of 23 years. Hence, as per our traditions, there is no verse of Quran which is ambiguous to Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, or ambiguous to beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. As narration mentioned, if you truly want to unpack and unlock the secret of ambiguous verses, you need to take it back to those who know Quran and know any other person but the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. As one day Qatada was teaching Quran, and Imam Bakr alayhi salam get to hear about it. Imam Bakr called Qatada. He said, "Qatada, I heard you are teaching Quran. Where do you get your information from? Is it from you or from someone else? If it's from you or from someone else, It simply means you are teaching Quran from your own self opinion. And the Holy Prophet mentioned, "Man fassara al-Quran biraye falyatabawwa maq'adahu min Allah." Whoever explains Quran through self opinion, he or she should prepare for his place in Jahannam on the day of Qiyamah. So therefore, then Imam Bakr said to him, "Innama ya'rifu al-Qur'ana man khutiba bih." Indeed, he knows Quran, the one to whom Quran was revealed. Who? Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Today, some people want to distance us from Ahlul Bayt. Some are saying Quran is not enough. It's impossible to understand the Quran without depending on Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Ahlul Bayt are the walking Quran. We cannot do without Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. And of course, it is also not acceptable to hold the unto Ahlul Bayt at the expense of glorious Quran. Suffice to say, from that famous tradition of beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that he leaves two weighty things for us: the book of Allah and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. So my dear brother, my dear sister, I humbly request you, use this opportunity of the holy month of Ramadan to establish affiliation with glorious Quran. Do a lot when it comes to Quran. It is our way of salvation. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in chapter Tariq, verse 13 and 14 said, "Innahu laqawlun fasl wa ma huwa bil hazl." He said, indeed, Quran is a decisive statement, and Quran is not a joke. The last stage of my examination, I've taken much of your time. Why did Allah send Jibreel to prophets? Does this mean that Jibreel knew Quran before prophets, and prophet did not know Quran before the coming Jibreel? If we say prophet did not know Quran before the coming of Jibreel, this will mean Jibreel more learned than prophet. And if we say no, prophet knew Quran before the coming of Jibreel, then the question is, what's the purpose of the coming of Jibreel alayhi salam to the holy prophet? No doubt, as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam, we inherited this from Ahlul Bayt, that the holy prophet of Islam knew Quran in and out before the coming of Jibreel alayhi salam to the prophet. And this is what few verses of glorious Quran highlight, isn't it? One verse of Quran beautifully, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, 75:16, "La tuharrik bihi lisanaka lita'jala bihi. Inna alayna jama'ahu wa Qur'ana." He said, don't expose the teachings of this Quran to people before we revealed it to you. You know what? You know it, but don't expose it to them before Jibreel comes to you. And another ayah said, "La ta'jal bil Quran qabla an yuqda ilayka wahyu." Quran 20 verse 114. Don't rush in disseminating it before we send revelation to, meaning what, before we send Jibreel to you. Here our scholars, when they dissected these two verses, they said Rasulullah knew in and out of Quran before Jibreel came, and he really wanted to share it with the Ummah. But Allah told him, wait until Jibreel come to you, because there is a reason as to why I am sending Jibreel to you. And no doubt, Rasulullah, Quran makes it very clear, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Rasul is a rahma for alameen. Alameen means what? The entire universe, including the angels, including Jibreel. Rasulullah is way higher than Jibreel, alayhi salatu wasalam. Now the question remains, if that is the case, why did Jibreel come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam? The reason is very simple, and that will be my last stage of the examination. That everything that you see, my dear brother and sister, again, is of two dimensions: physical dimension and mystical or spiritual dimension. Let's take an example. Take a mountain or a stone. A stone has two forms of dimensions: physical and spiritual. What is the physical dimension of a stone? Is the stone that you see, what's the size of the stone? where is the stone situated or located. That's the physical dimension of the stone. But stone or any other mountain has what? Spiritual dimension. Where Quran makes it very clear, Quran 17 verse 44, where in min shay'in illa yusabbihu bihamdi rabbih. Said there is nothing that we have created except it praises and glorifies Allah. So the secret or the spiritual dimension of stone or any other creature is what? It praises and worships Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Likewise, when you come to the glorious Quran, Quran has physical dimension and it has spiritual dimension. What is the physical dimension of Quran? Is this that you see, this the physical dimension of Quran. The size, the width, the length, that's the physical dimension of glorious Quran. But what is the spiritual dimension of glorious Quran? Go to Quran 59 verse 21. Allah says, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. If we were to send this Quran to the mountains will split and break apart on account of the fear of Allah. That's the power of Quran. It penetrates every single thing that comes into contact with it. Now question, why did Allah send Rasulullah or sent Jibreel to Rasulullah, where Rasulullah knew Quran, where Rasulullah is way much better than Jibreel, more knowledgeable than Jibreel alayhi salam? So it's simply because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wanted Rasulullah to have a first-hand experience on the impact of Quran on angels. Because Quran has impact at athir al-ruhi, has that very strong spiritual and emotional impact on everyone. So Rasulullah knew that. But Allah wanted to show it to Rasulullah practically, how impactful Quran was on Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And hence Jibreel came to Rasulullah. Otherwise, he did not come to teach Rasulullah. أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورُ مُحَمَّدْ بَعَدْ. The first thing that Allah created is the light of Prophet. And from that light, Allah created everything, isn't it? No narration mentioned the light of Prophet and Amir al-Mu'mineen, or the light of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. Some scholars even made an argument that, okay, let's even assume, hypothetically, that Jibreel came to Rasulullah with that message which Rasulullah didn't know, which we said he knew. But hypothetically, assume it. So no, it's just a messenger. It's like you at work, you give a letter to your messenger to take it to your colleague or your partner. That messenger is not higher than the colleague or partner. In the case of Musa and Khidr, Musa is higher than Khidr. But Khidr showed Musa certain ways. It doesn't mean that Musa is lower than Khidr. So therefore, mu'minin and mu'minat, this is an opportunity to hold unto Quran. At least, reflect on one verse of Quran every day in this month. And seek to continue with that pace after the holy month of Ramadan. The holy prophet mentioned, مَنْ كَرْعَ فِيهِ آيَةً مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ عَجَرْ مَنْ خَتَمَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي غَيْرِهِ مِنَ الشُّهُورِ. Whoever recite one verse of glorious Quran in this holy month of Ramadan, you will be given the reward equivalent to completing the entire Quran in any other month of the year. So therefore, mu'minin and mu'minat, the garad, the aim of this discourse or the takeaway from this discussion is to start thinking seriously on affiliating oneself with glorious Quran if you have not embarked on. And no doubt, we are in the month of Quran and we are preparing ourselves to welcome the holy night of Quran, which is the night of Qadr. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to illuminate our hearts with the nuraniya of Quran and grant us shafa to Quran and Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, and make us worthy of being his true slaves and servants who will hold unto Quran in their lives. Wa akhir da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi tayyibin al-tahirin.